Well, hello and a very warm welcome to our online worship for All Saints Sunday. It's wonderful to have you with us, and hopefully in the service there'll be something for everybody. And where words are shown on the screen, please do join in with the words shown in yellow type. Now, you might be asking yourself the question, what is All Saints Sunday? Well, it's always the Sunday closest to the 1st of November. 1st of November is All Saints Day. But let me show you a little video telling you a bit more about what All Saints Sunday is. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. In all our weakness and strength, with our youth-filled spirits and aging bodies, we come to be your people, O God. Strong in faith and eager with questions, singing our praise and whispering our prayers, we come to be your people, O God. Filled with saintly determination, yet mindful of our human limitations, we come to be your people, O God. Made strong in your endless love for us, we know ourselves to be yours, and we come to be your people, O God. So may we truly become your people today. Amen. Well, we've got some good songs to sing together on this All Saints Sunday, and the first one is Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer.
Oh,
Let's now take a few moments to say sorry to God for all the wrong things we do, think, and say. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As sisters and brothers in God's family, we come together to ask our Father for forgiveness. You made us to be one family, yet we have divided humanity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You were born a Jew to reconcile all people, yet we have brought disharmony among races. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You rejoice in our differences, yet we make them a cause of enmity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And so may God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the special prayer for All Saints Sunday. God of holiness, your glory is proclaimed in every age. As we rejoice in the faith of your saints, inspire us to follow their example with boldness and joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, today's Bible reading is what we know as the Beatitudes. And David will be talking about that passage a little bit later on. But for our children's story time today, we're going to think about part of that word, beatitude. And so what does it mean when we need to have a good attitude? What is having a good attitude? Well, let's find out.
Okay, fine, whatever. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas. And have you ever noticed how there are some words that are like good words, but they kind of can be turned into almost bad words? You know what I mean? Like the word fine. Like if somebody says fine, usually it's, you know, fine is supposed to mean good. But if you ask somebody how they're doing and they say fine, you know that they're not fine. And you can tell by their attitude, you know, what it is that they actually mean. You know, they said fine, but they're not actually fine. Actually, right now, I am currently grounded for saying the word okay, right? And okay means like good, right? Or, you know, okay, like yes. Well, my mom, she, you know, I was watching TV and she asked me to clean my room and I just, you know, I didn't really respond and I was watching the TV and she, you know, a few minutes later, she asked me again. She said, "Douglas, you got to go clean your room." And I still didn't answer. And the third time she was like, "Douglas, I said, go clean your room." And I went, "Ugh, okay." Boom, grounded. And I was going to go clean my room. And I said, "Yeah, I'll go clean my room." But I definitely was not saying it with a good attitude. I definitely had some sass thrown into that okay. You know what I mean? And here's the thing is God really cares about what's on the inside. He doesn't just care what you say or what you do. He cares about why you say it. He cares about how you say it. And he cares about why you do it and how you do it. God cares about what's inside. You know, I had every intention. I was going to go clean my room, and I said, "Yes, I'll go clean my room," you know, but I didn't say it like that. I said, "Okay," you know, after like huffing and puffing, you know. I was doing what I was supposed to be doing, but I was not doing it in the right way, and I got in trouble for it. And I should have gotten in trouble for it. I honestly feel bad that I sassed my mom like that. You know, in the Bible, the people that Jesus got most mad at were the people who were doing and saying all the right things. But deep down in their hearts, they were prideful and they were jealous and they were mean and hateful. And God cared more about that than the outward appearance, you know, just them following the rules. God cares about what's on the inside. And so my challenge to you guys today is that you would really watch your attitudes. You know, and that's a challenge for me too. I want to do better at that also. Because sometimes we try to, you know, punish people, right, with the way that we behave. You know, yeah, I'll do the thing, but I'm going to be real snarky about it. I'm going to be real sassy about it. I'm going to be real mean about it. That's not what God wants. God wants us to honor him in all that we do. And that really, really includes how we do what we do. You know, I don't really like cleaning my room. I don't know anybody that likes cleaning their room, but it's something I got to do. And so I want to try to do it with a good attitude, because that's what God wants me to do. Not just even for other people, but even in my own heart. If you've got a good attitude, that can really change your outlook on life. God wants us to be kind to other people with our words and with our actions. God doesn't just care about what you say or what you do. God cares about what's on the inside.
Well, he's a fun character, isn't he? Well, it's now our time to sing. And as it's All Saints Sunday, we're going to have the old favourite song, When the Saints Go Marching In. But this is a new version of it. And there'll be some dance moves for you to join in with as well. So let's have this song together, When the Saints Go Marching In. And I'll hope you'll enjoy it. Well, you must be really exhausted after that. So please sit down, have a rest, and Barbara is going to bring us today's Bible reading.
Matthew 5, verses 1 to 12. Introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the pure in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord.
Well, as we prepare to hear from David today, we're going to sing again. And our next song is "Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God."
Good morning, everybody. Are there things that you find off-putting, perhaps something you hear or see, a memory perhaps, or a smell? My mother refused to cook tripe for my father, and I have to say I think she was entirely justified. Everything about it was off-putting. It looked revolting, it smelt revolting, I never tasted it. Perhaps you can think of something in your experience that you found off-putting. And here's a confession from me. As a teenage boy, desperate to improve his rugby skills, his fitness for water polo, to stay up to speed with the latest tastes in music, to become a masculine young man surrounded by beautiful girls, I found the Beatitudes just a bit off-putting. To start with, there's the name. Now, Jesus never gave them this title. The church, however, has to give things titles, preferably wafty and impenetrable. And back in the midst of time, a committee sat down and decided to call these verses at the start of Matthew chapter 5, the Beatitudes. Now, the Eastern Orthodox Church thought this was just wonderful, and they used it as a title for the upper echelons of management. In the Church of England, we call them bishops. Your beatitude was the salutation. Elsewhere on the spectrum, the Beatitude Beauty Product Company offer for £40 a bottle of Peace Bath Oil, which will turn your bathroom into a divine peaceful haven on the days when you need intensive relaxation. Now, anything intensive doesn't sound particularly relaxing, does it? So these verses for me as a teenager seemed just to be a list of inadequate people. The poor in spirit, the meek, the pure in heart. Well, that was never going to be me as a teenage boy. And there was certainly no place in the front row of the scrum for the meek or the poor in spirit. And looking at the list, I would have preferred not to have been any of them. So what's Jesus doing here? Well, the answer is quite simple, really, and it took me a while to catch on, but he's doing what he always does, and that's turning the values of our world, our culture, our traditions upside down. We don't read, blessed are the assertive, blessing are the super confident, blessing are those who plough through everything to achieve. Now, why would Jesus do this upside down bit? Now, the old Westminster Catechism, which was a sort of spiritual Q&A session to make sure everybody was on the same page, is an extension of the creed, really, puts it like this. The question, what is the chief end of man? In other words, what's the purpose of being a human being? And the answer is, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Now that sounds pretty good. I'm up for some of that. I'd like to glorify God and enjoy God forever. Yes, please, as long as that doesn't mean more church. So how do I make that happen? And here's where the Beatitudes come in. Let's change the name. Dr. Billy Graham extended it to Beautiful Attitudes, and I found that really, really helpful. Now there are many definitions and explanations as to what blessed means. And one thing's for sure, it doesn't mean a wonderful bath time. I look at it like this. I think it means walking with God. It's the very first word in the book of Psalms, the Bible songbook that shows us how to walk with God through this life and into eternity. And if you're walking this life with God, then you're blessed. You're the right person doing the right thing in the right place at the right time for the right reason. Is it a coincidence that Matthew starts Jesus' teaching with this list? I don't think so, because unless we're living out these beautiful attitudes, then the rest of his teaching won't have any solid foundation to support it in our lives. How do we know this? Because Matthew records Jesus as finishing this Sermon on the Mount with the story of the house built on the rock and the house built on the sand. If your foundations are right, then the walk with God will be possible. So what are the ideal building conditions for a life spent walking with God? Now, that I appreciate that's a bit of a mixed metaphor, but my father was born in Cork, and that's my excuse. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, poor in spirit doesn't mean the nervous or the timid. It means those who know that they are spiritually poor, those who have learnt that they need to pray. You can't walk with God in complete silence. Those who have learnt that they need to read more and more of his word and to make a point of reading it, because only when you have an awareness of God's riches can you realise how poor you are spiritually in comparison. And when you realise this, when the penny drops that just church, just hymns, just knowing all the long words isn't enough, then God says, you're ready for the kingdom. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, there's lots of definitions of meek. And the one most people picture is a person who's prepared to go along with whatever other people want to do. A bit spiritless, tame, submissive. Well, sorry, Jesus, but they don't deserve to inherit anything. And if they did, they wouldn't have a clue what to do with it. Well, that's the negative. Positive meekness is having power, but not always using it. Restraint, humility, being able to remain calm and subdued in the face of provocation. And if you're prepared to forego all the world's rewards for assertiveness, because walking through life with God is of greater importance to you, being meek in God's presence, then you'll inherit the earth. Will I be a billionaire? No. And it won't matter, because the Lord is my shepherd. Therefore, I lack nothing. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled. Now we see, don't we, those who hunger and thirst after popularity on social media are always left hungry for more. It's never enough. Robert Maxwell, the multi-millionaire newspaper owner, night after night gambling millions at a casino because the money he had was never enough. Archie Karras, a man who arrived at Las Vegas with $50, turned it into $40 million and then lost it all again, said, money is nothing, because the things I really want, money can't buy. So what's grabbed your attention? What is it that drives you? What is it that makes you move? And why should it be righteousness? Many people think that righteousness just means, well, being right. God sees it differently. No one is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. Paul writing in Romans chapter 3, and he goes on in chapter 4 to say this: Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteous. Now, our righteousness, the reason that we can walk through life day by day with God, is because of the righteousness of Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he became sin who knew no sin, so that we might become his righteousness. Our righteousness in God's sight came at a price. And so God says, make it your priority. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall be shown mercy. Enough said. What a beautiful attitude. Love thy neighbour as thyself. Matthew 22:37. Jesus goes on, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Now, what comes before loving your neighbour as yourself? Jesus said this, didn't he? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. In other words, there are no higher priorities. There are no more pressing matters. Nothing gets in the way. And that's the purity of heart that Jesus is referring to. A heart devoted to God. A heart centered on God. And that's so hard, isn't it, for us today? What a struggle. There are so many distractions. Now, we used to sing a little song when I was in Sunday school. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim. Not that they'll go away, but they'll grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Now, in our world and in our land, there no longer seems to be any middle ground. Never has division seemed so all-pervading. Political division, economic division, social division, and now even medical and health division. Yet God is a God of peace. One of his names in the Old Testament is Jehovah Shalom, God, our peace. And Jesus' precious gift to his followers after his resurrection was peace. Peace I leave with you. And a focal part of our communion service is when we share the peace. As a church, we exist to show the world that peace is possible and that lasting peace is only to be found in the person of the Prince of Peace, our Lord Jesus. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We sometimes feel blessed for the opposite reason, don't we? As followers of Jesus Christ in the UK, people aren't insulting us. They're not persecuting us, saying all kinds of evil against us because of Jesus. But the fastest growing churches in the world today are in places where naming Jesus as your Saviour and Lord can only lead to trouble. But if we walk through this life with God every step of the way, there will be trouble ahead. But the blessing will remain and can never be taken away. Now, did you spot the deliberate mistake earlier? I left out number two. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Now, bereavement is one of the toughest things that our human existence has to deal with. To lose a loved one is tough enough, but having to reshape our lives to deal with the loss can be almost unbearable. Today, not just in the UK, but all over the world, everyone is bereaved. Everybody is in mourning because we've lost all the things that ground us. Contact with other human beings is virtually impossible. Families are separated, weddings cancelled, no baptisms, church services very, very strange, no visits to care homes, no contact with the elderly loved ones, no hugs for grandchildren. Lockdown equals loneliness. Shielding equals separation and solitude. We're in mourning. We've lost the things that comprise our humanity. There's no good news on TV. Professional sport is now meaningless. Nobody cares anymore. Art has been grounded. You can't see it live. You can't hear it live. The West End of London's like a mausoleum. The city streets are empty. It's the same all around the world. We're probably not even going to have our traditional Christmas. We're in mourning and it's open-ended. Nobody can tell us when or how it can end. But this morning, Jesus says to us, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And we've seen it already, haven't we? We've seen it online. We've read it in emails. We've experienced it in our hearts because of the beautiful attitudes. We can be 100% certain that those who mourn will be comforted. Because we're citizens of God's kingdom. We've inherited all our heart's desire or need. We've sought God and he's filled us. We've experienced his mercy in our lives, even today already. And we'll see God because we are his sons and daughters. No persecution or problem can take that away from us because we are walking through this life with God. We are blessed. Jesus made that possible, And to our world today, to our politicians, to our economists, to our neighbours who are at their wits' end, we can radiate this truth to them. Blessed are those who mourn, because they will be comforted. Now, God bless each and every one of you as you walk with him through these difficult and trying days. And may God write these beautiful attitudes into our whole life and our thinking. God bless you.
Let us now respond by affirming our faith together. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we welcome Gilly to come and lead us in our time to pray.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, help us to see that we are spiritually bankrupt without you. We find it hard to believe that apart from you we can do nothing. Forgive us and free us from self-sufficiency, and help us to trust you with every part of our lives. We rejoice that you've not left us to ourselves in our poverty, but you have made us rich in Christ. Give us true humility and genuine repentance, so that your kingdom comes through us to earth as it is in heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. There are many things we mourn in this life: loss due to death or aging, loss of good health, jobs or relationships. God of comfort, we thank you that in your compassion you draw close to the brokenhearted and comfort everyone who mourns. Lord, we ask that you would bring healing and wholeness to those known to us who are sick, and comfort those of us who have lost loved ones. Help us, Heavenly Father, to give your comfort to those who mourn. We look forward to that day when you will wipe away every tear. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Please lead us, Holy God, in the ways of humility. Help us to stand in solidarity with the oppressed and marginalized. Show us your presence in the faces of those that the world forgets. Humble King, we confess that meekness does not come easily to us. Forgive us for thinking of ourselves more highly than we ought. Give us the faith to live simple, humble lives of self-awareness, which lead to love and service of others. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Lord Jesus, you told us that when we seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, then all the things we need will be provided. Give us the courage to stand up to injustice, even when we are afraid. Help us to trust in your words, that when we seek you, loving mercy, acting justly, walking humbly, that you will provide. Stir in us a desire to know and love you more, that we may find satisfaction in seeking your will rather than ours. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Father of mercies, we thank you that you are merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And yet even as you show us mercy, we find it difficult to show mercy to others and can be quick to pass judgment on those who wrong us. Lord, help us to be merciful so that our loved ones, our co-workers, and the unbelieving world may see your mercy and grace in us. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Holy God, forgive us, we pray, for the impurity of our hearts. Please help us to lay down the pride, greed, envy, anger, and lust in our hearts. Refine our desires so that your will is our will. We thank you, Lord God, for your forgiveness and grace given to us because of Jesus' death on the cross. Holy God, set our minds and hearts on things above. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Violence seems to be everywhere in our world. Prince of Peace, we pray for all involved in making or maintaining peace. We ask you to give them strength, encouragement when they feel the task is beyond them, and protection when they are in danger. Let us bring before God any relationships in our villages, in our churches, in our families, where conflict persists and our hearts feel hardened towards those involved. Lord, soften our hearts, we pray. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. We pray for those who suffer and even die as they stand up for justice, freedom, and basic human rights. As we gather so freely this morning to worship you, Lord, we pray for safety for those who do so at risk of prison or even death. Shield them from danger, we pray. Strengthen us so that we may be willing to stand up for what we know is true. Give us grace and peace as we speak of Jesus, and courage when this comes at a cost. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Let's now share in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn together this morning is a wonderful hymn, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise." So let's join in with this hymn together.
Oh,
I'd like to thank you for worshipping with us again today. It's great to join together like this. And just before our closing prayers, just a reminder that our face-to-face church services, where they are and what times they are, will be shown on the screen at the end. And also on there, we'll be showing you the services we're hoping to do on Remembrance Sunday as well. Now, if you're going to be joining us at one of our Remembrance Sunday services, just to say that at Hellions, the whole service will be inside the church, so the normal Sunday worship rules apply. At Ashen, we'll be starting off in the churchyard and then going into the church. So again, the same there, normal Sunday worship rules apply. Over at Birdbrook, it is the same situation, out in the churchyard and then into the church. The two exceptions are at Steeple, Bumpstead and Ridgewell, where the act of remembrance will be at the village war memorials first and then followed by a service in church. The act of remembrance at the war memorials, in the case of these two, is being handled and organised by the parish councils, they are trying to minimise the number of people who gather there. But if you do go there to gather, do please wear your face coverings, practice social distancing, only stand in groups of people who are from your household, because we must abide by the Tier 2 rules. But it will be good to welcome you together to carry out those acts of remembrance. There will, of course, always also be an act of remembrance for Remembrance Sunday online as well, so you can join us in that way too. I hope I made that clear. At times it sounded as if I wasn't putting proper sentences together, but I hope you got the gist of what I was saying. But now, our closing prayer. God's people have celebrated all that God has done, from creation to the cross, to the saints who have lived among us. Now we go from this place to the workplace, the home place, the marketplace, and every place living as God's own people. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Some say this world of trouble.